Okay.
United States of America, a proclamation. Whereas it is the duty of all nations to acknowledge the providence of Almighty God, to obey His will, be grateful for His benefits, and humbly to implore His protection and favor. And whereas both houses of Congress have by their joint committee requested me to recommend to the people of the United States a day of public thanksgiving and prayer to be observed by acknowledging with grateful hearts the many signal favors of Almighty God, especially by affording them an opportunity peaceably to establish a form of government for their safety and happiness. Now, therefore, I do recommend and assign Thursday, the 26th day of November next, to be devoted by the people of these states to the service of that great and glorious being, who is the beneficent author of all that is good,
amen,
all that is, or all that will be.
Amen.
That we may then all unite in rendering unto Him our sincere and humble thanks for His kind care and protection of the people of this country previous to their becoming a nation, for the signal and manifold mercies and the favorable interpositions of His providence which we experienced in the course and conclusion of the late war, for the great degree of tranquility, union, and plenty, which we have since enjoyed, for the peaceable and rational manner in which we have been enabled to establish constitutions of government for our safety and happiness, and particularly the national one now lately instituted, for the civil and religious liberty with which we are blessed, and the means we have of acquiring and diffusing useful knowledge, and in general for all the great and various favors for which He has been pleased to confer upon us. And also that we may then unite in most humbly offering our prayers and supplications to the great Lord and ruler of nations, and beseech Him to pardon our national and other transgressions, to enable us all, whether in public or private stations, to perform our several and relative duties properly and punctually, to render our national government a blessing to all the people, but constantly being a government of wise, just, constitutional laws, discreetly and faithfully executed and obeyed, to protect and guide all sovereigns and nations, especially such as have shown kindness unto us, and to bless them with good government, peace, and concord, to promote the knowledge and practice of true religion and virtue, and the increase of science among them and us, and generally to grant unto all mankind such a degree of temporal prosperity as He alone knows to be best. Given under my hand at the city of New York, the 3rd day of October, in the year of our Lord, 1789. Signed, George Washington.
Amen.
This is a proclamation that cannot be given today in our society. We have one party that openly has revoked and renounced the name of God. And we have another party that is afraid to even mention His name, lest it offend somebody. We even have that same government in our society that has demanded that God not be in our politics, our schools, or even our homes. And we've had some that suggest that we shouldn't even have Thanksgiving this year, or even imply that we have nothing to be thankful for. I soundly reject that.
Amen.
We have so
Amen.
Much to be thankful.
That's right.
And I'm thankful that we're here this morning together as a congregation that we can celebrate as believers of God. I'm thankful for this praise team, and I think it's an incredible blessing with Rebecca and her voice, at least just to hear that each day. Especially in the dark times, Father, You're there for us, each and every moment, each and every step of the way that we take. You're there guiding us, Father, sometimes even carrying us. Especially in these days, Father, we have more than ever need to thank You for each and every blessing that You give and confer upon us. Even with the uncertainty of the current days with the COVID virus, with the uncertainty of the results of this election, You've allowed us to live in a nation, Father, that for the moment still remains free, where we can freely worship You, Father, in the open, where we can choose to proclaim Your name, if that's, if we have the courage to do so, Father. As Joshua once said, as for me and my house, I will serve the Lord.
Amen.
And I'm thankful, Father, that I'm among other believers here today, that we openly are willing to make that stand for You, Father. Most importantly, Father, I thank You for the gift of Your Son, the gift of his death upon the cross, the shedding of his blood for our sins, but most importantly for his resurrection. And that you wanted to love us so much, Father, that you sent him, that you found a way that despite our sin, you still chose to have a relationship with each and every one of us, Father. I ask that you be with Pastor John as he brings this message of thankfulness to us, that it be something that you place upon our hearts. I thank you for this time together, for this service, and for this fellowship afterwards, Father. May you walk among us, Father, and be with us today. Pray all these things in the name of your precious Son, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Ralph. Yeah, when you read that, I was just thinking how contemporary that is for us today. I mean, some of the things that were written back over 200 years ago, it's like, we need that absolutely today. So. And I do thank Rebecca, and I always say this, I'm glad that she got her looks and her voice from her mom, not me. we're glad you're here with us this morning to worship. And fellowship a little bit later, we'll go out and have a good lunch meal together. I'm looking forward to that. Just sit around and have that time of fellowship. If you are visiting with us today, there's a pull-out or tear-out in the bulletin. Just fill that out, put your name and information in there, and we'd love to just have a record of your attendance with us today. We won't send the church SWAT team out to hassle you at your house or anything like that, I promise. So we're here to just fellowship and worship together. Just a couple quick announcements before our greeting time. Jim Lukey is the deacon of the week, but just pray for him. He's a little bit under the weather, but you can call upon him this week if you need to, or some of the other deacons are there. You can call the office as well. And the church office is not in the bulletin this week, but the church office will be open Monday and Tuesday this week, and will be closed Wednesday and Thursday for Thanksgiving break. But if you need anything, I think you know how to contact me. We're here for you. Anything we can do for you, we're here. So. All right, this time, just want to ask that we stand up and greet one another and give a fist bump or a COVID safe handshake or whatever you'd like to do. Then we'll come back for a time with the children's sermon with Bobby Watkins.
Thank you. doing our children's message from here today. Somebody just shipped that answer. So I'm going to do it up here. As you know, right here. And we're talking about boys and girls and adults alike. Season of Thanksgiving, right? And this is a familiar story. And I might have mentioned it last week. I wasn't necessarily going to go with it, but I'm glad to share it again this morning. And it's just something I get to remind for me as much as anything, and maybe this message is for me, about being thankful and about saying the words, thank you. And it goes back to my mom and dad always taught us, probably a lot like you guys, boys and girls, as adults, it might be a year or two older than y'all. Our parents teach us to say things like thank you and please and yes ma'am.
Amen.
No ma'am. Yes sir. No sir. You know, I can remember some of the things my mom and dad did not like to hear is a response when you said yep.
Yep.
You know, I don't care for that. I agree with that now. And it really taught me and kind of got ingrained in there. It's probably like, okay, yes sir, you know. But it really is just a part of your being, what you're trained. And that kind of goes hand in hand with the things of God, where our parents are imparting those things to us. But they're doing it for a reason. And they're trying to help us just to have some good basic manners, but having an attitude of thankfulness and being grateful is directly in line with our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
If you've been listening to our pastor preach the past few weeks, and I would say any week really, these have been specifically designed on thankfulness, but any message that comes from God's Word is something we should be thankful for.
Amen.
I appreciate a pastor who preaches the Word, stands on the Word, lifts up the name of Jesus every single time he has the takes a stand.
Amen.
He's not trying to entertain anyone. No, he may tell a joke or two. You can judge yourself. It's funny or not. I usually laugh at him, so I'm not sure what that means. But I just appreciate that about him. Had the opportunity to go to a wedding recently, and when you give gifts at weddings or you go to baby showers, you always get a thank you note, and that's appreciated. But it's a response to being given something. And I'll share this with Scripture. It may be familiar to you or not, but I want to read it. Comes from the 17th chapter of Luke. And it talks about a group of 10 afflicted with leprosy and their response to being healed. It says on verse 11, it says, now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him, and they stood at a distance. I thought that was just kind of appropriate these days as we talk about distance. But these people, if you know much about being a leper, you were outcast. You were set aside, outside of the norms of society, right? Often in like a colony of your own, you were told you have to stay over here, okay? You were not included, if you will. So you can imagine if you've experienced any of the social distancing we live through now, or any time if you may have been in contact tracing, or maybe even if you have, you know, a positive test, and maybe you've had the virus, you're called to distance yourself or even isolate yourself. When you think about that, man, I really, as I start to think about things, I think about the times the Apostle Paul was isolated. It really comes to that. That's not what I'm sharing about this morning. But we can really kind of think about being at a distance. So thankfully, we're able to be here and not have to isolate, right? We're thankful for that. It says in verse 13, and they called out in a loud voice, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. And he saw them, he said, go show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw it was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at the feet of Jesus and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. And Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? We love to tell ourselves and we want to think to ourselves we have the attitude of the 1 out of 10, right? But do we all the time? Now, obviously, they were cleansed of a dreadful disease. And you just gotta, you try to picture in your mind boys and girls and adults, as they were going to the priest, they were cleansed. They just imagine what it looked like. Their hands became healed. Their skin became healed. You know what leprosy is? It's a skin disease. And just, I just think about their reaction to that, and just like my mind drifts where those other nine were. But we know where the one went in his response. His response was to go back to the one who healed him and recognize the one who healed him and tell him, thank you. And I just wonder, when we experience the miraculous in our lives, we miss the miraculous. The miraculous happens every day. We think,
amen.
Are the really miracles happening? Folks, if someone gets healed of anything, it's a miracle.
Amen.
You can say it's medicine, but God's the one who gave us medicine. God's the one who gave us science and technology to heal people of various minor sicknesses and diseases to major ones. We see these stories of senior adults who get afflicted with this coronavirus. And it's miraculous when they get healed, because the majority don't. That's what statistics show. But the miraculous happens every day. There are babies born every day. There are miraculous things happening. But do we thank God for the miraculous? The ability to get out of bed is miraculous. Those that don't have the ability to get out of bed. I can tell you somebody who would love to be here this morning. He doesn't miss church at all. That's Jim Lick. I can tell you he wanted to be here. That's Miss Shirley, she'll tell you. Mr. Jim loves to go. He couldn't be here this morning. His back's bothering. He loves to be in the house of God because he loves to kind of worship his Lord.
Amen.
So be thankful that you can stand upright, your back's not behind you, you're able to be here. We can be thankful. This is a reminder, man. I'm not calling anybody here. I'm calling myself out. The boys and girls, when your parents ask you to do things, be thankful. Be thankful when they give you. Maybe it's not the meal you want. Maybe it's not your preferred meal. Maybe it's not the food you asked for. Be thankful. Maybe it's not the outfit you preferred your mom bought you, or the new shoes that you wanted. Be thankful. Adults, when you get in your car and it cranks up on a cold morning and it warms up, you drive it to work or another destination, be thankful. When your kids wake up in the morning and they don't have a sickness, you're not having to get them up early to take them down to children's health care for treatments, be thankful. Mm-hmm. In this season of unknown, this is still a lot of unknown in our world these days, let us be thankful. Let us be mindful of what we do have, as John shared a while ago, and Ralph shared. Sometimes we look at what we don't have. I am very, very guilty of that. But let us be mindful, boys and girls, of what God has blessed us with, God has given us.
Amen.
From our health to the air we breathe, to the very freedom we have in this country to worship the Lord Jesus Christ without fear, persecution. To choose. Father in heaven, we give you praise and glory and honor this morning. Thank you for this place, this church, where we can gather, no matter where we're from, no matter our background, no matter our ethnicity, no matter where we grew up, no matter the size of our house, no matter the car we drive, we can come to your house and worship you, Spirit of truth. We can sing songs to your name. May our desire in our hearts, as boys and girls, and as adults, be to do so, be to worship you, thank you, most of all, God, most of all, I'd be remiss if not share the gift of salvation. Jesus, I thank you for saving my soul.
Amen.
There's nothing I can do to save myself. None of us can save our own selves. only name given to us under heaven by which we will be saved. It is our true name, Jesus.
Amen.
And we praise you for that. Thank you for giving your life on the cross for our sins, for my sins, for the sins of the world. Rising again, we might have victory over death on this side of eternity and for eternity. I thank you for all the boys and girls that can hear me today. I pray that you bless their families. Bless this week, because they had a week off from school. Give them a great week of Thanksgiving as they enjoy our time together, Lord. Thank you for this place. Thank you, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Open up my eyes and actually apply those words, God. Pray that we can put our trust in you, not in anything else, not in the government, not in other people, God, that we put our trust in you, that we build our lives around you, and you are the only firm foundation, God. Thank you for this week, and thank you for the blessings that you've given us, and for your grace and how you love us, God. And I pray that we continue to have an attitude of thanksgiving, and that we can just continue to put things at your feet, continue to rely on you, and lean on you, God, and treasure your word, and love you, God, the way you love us. And I thank you for that. And I praise the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, praise team. One day we're going to collide and smash each other up here. Sorry, I'm here. All right, good morning, church. Good morning. All right. All right, I'm excited to be here. Thank you, Christine. Just listen to that last song. It reminded me of the verse we're kind of focusing on this past 3 weeks. From Colossians 2, 6, 7, the song says, you know, fill me. There, show me who you are and fill me. Remind me of that verse. I'm just reading to you Colossians chapter 2, verse 6 and 7 says, so then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. If we want to overflow with thankfulness, we want to overflow into people's lives this season, this Thanksgiving season, Christmas is coming up. We've got to ask the Lord, we have to make sure we do our part. Say, Lord, fill me. I want to be a blessing to somebody else. I need to pour out into someone else's life. But the only way that we can do that, folks, it's not a trick. You know, we have to be filled ourselves. We have to come to the well. We have to go to the Holy Spirit. We have to go to His Word. We have to practice the spiritual discipline. So there's the main sermon for the sermon. All right, if you got your Bibles, we're going to be in the Old Testament this morning in 1 Chronicles chapter 16. When I was looking at the 3 weeks of Thanksgiving and being thankful, there's so many passages, and I've learned a lot kind of digging in a little bit that there's not one passage that really deals with Thanksgiving in depth, but really it's just kind of spread out all throughout the Bible. It's a part of who the people of God were in the Old Testament and the New Testament. They were thankful for everything they had. And there were several passages I didn't get to. I'm glad Bobby, he's out working a little bit, doing some of those out there. But I'm glad I chose to set aside the Tim Lovers thing because he did that this morning. That must have been the Lord there just working on that together. So maybe another Thanksgiving we'll look at that another time. But there's so many things. This passage in 1 Chronicles 16 was just interesting to me. There were things in it that I had never seen as I read through the Bible before. I'm like, wow, this has some meat in it, I think, for us today to look at and help us learn how to be thankful. So that's what we're going to do this morning. This is a Psalm of David that's not in the Psalms. So there's 150 Psalms in the Book of Psalms, but this is a Psalm where David wrote this after we're going to get to it in just a minute. And so it's kind of interesting. There's a Psalm that's not in the Psalm. So and there's several ones that are like that. So this is a Psalm where the Philistines had taken the ark and captured it, and David and the army got it back from the Lord. And they brought it back to the house, and it was a great time of Thanksgiving. That's kind of the scenario that's going on here. You can follow along in 2 Samuel chapter 6. It describes the same thing. We'll go back to that in just a minute, of the differences between 1 Kings and then 1 Chronicles. We'll look at the differences there, and I'm going to show you something today. But let's go ahead and get into it, and let's look at this. This psalm, first of all, also, too, before I get to it, let's read verses 1 through 4. I'm just kind of breaking it up this morning because it is a little bit of a long chapter. We'll just kind of take it bit by bit and look at it. Let me read the first four verses here in chapter 16. It says, they brought the ark of God and set it inside the tent that David had pitched for it. They presented burnt offerings and fellowship offerings before God, After David had finished sacrificing the burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, he blessed the people in the name of the Lord. He gave them a loaf of bread and a cake of dates and raisins, and a cake of raisins each to each Israelite man and woman. He appointed some of the Levites to minister before the ark of the Lord to make a petition to give thanks and to praise the Lord, the God of Israel. When I read that, I thought, man, that sounds a lot like one of the first Thanksgivings. they shared food. David gave, I'll look at that. So that's almost like the first biblical fruitcake right there. There's a cake of dates and raisins. Who likes fruitcake? I don't know. I'm picky, so I'm a weird eater, so you can, whatever. Okay, it's a few ways to do, so it's just, it looks weird. So. But anyway, so this they bring the ark back, and they've got the ark back in. They're having this great celebration. David is doing these sacrifices and burnt offerings to celebrate, and then he hands out food to everybody. So it just kind of reminded me of, hey, this is like Thanksgiving a little bit. You know, they're having that, and he's bringing the Levites in to start a blessing and give thanks and all these different things. So I appreciate what Ralph shared this morning with the first prayer that George Washington kind of gave for the first Thanksgiving. And so here we kind of see he even go back a lot further of maybe a time of Thanksgiving that was taking place here. So he composed this psalm, or he had one of his men, Asaph, to compose this psalm, and they wrote it, and it's actually, I didn't put this in your notes. If you want to kind of make notes on your bulletin this morning, this psalm in 1 Chronicles 16 is actually a combination of three different psalms. It's if you look at Psalm 105, Psalm 95, and Psalm 106, we won't do that this morning, but it's like he did a mixtape. Do you millennials go to mixtapes? he put it here, a mashup, or whatever you want to call it. He put them together, and he brought out certain points about some of these psalms. He put it all together in one, just to kind of bring an idea. So we're going to look at these points, and look at four different things from this psalm that David wrote in 1 Chronicles 16 this morning. So first thing I want to do is say, you know, we might be, okay, Pat and John, this is 2020. I'm almost to the point where I'm getting tired of talking about 2020. Who else is getting tired of talking about that? But, everything's different, right? Everything's changed. And we might have an attitude, like Bob mentioned a while ago, what do I have to be thankful for this year? I'm not getting together with my family, I'm not going to have my aunt's corporate dresses, whatever, But I want to point out some things that we as believers this morning, we can all be thankful for, no matter what. These are things that we can all do, we can all practice as believers in Christ, no matter where we are, no matter what we're going through. So the first one on your outline, number one, is that we thankful people share about God's acts. Number one, thankful people share about God's acts. This is in verses 8 through 11. So let me read that to you briefly here. It says, let me actually back up on the start verse 7 here. It says, that day David first committed to Asaph and to his associates this psalm of thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of his wonderful acts, glory in his holy name, let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look at the Lord, look to the Lord in his strength, seek his face always. Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles and his judgments he pronounced. And then I'll stop right there. But if you see kind of in the verbiage, several words here in this first section of the psalm, David is encouraging the Israelite people to share what the Lord has done for them. Now, that's what we think typically about Thanksgiving. That, we are thankful. And you may have traditions with your family or a group of people that you get with, and you maybe before you have your meal, you circle up and pray. But then I remember many times in my life we would kind of get together as a family, and each person would maybe go around. We didn't do this every year, but maybe several years. Each person would go around and share one thing that they're thankful for. You probably have traditions that you do with your family, something similar to that or whatever. And we all we want to share that time, the things that we're thankful for. That's kind of what Thanksgiving is for here. But I want you to see something, too. Look at verse 8. So give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known among the nations what he has done. It's not just for us to share amongst ourselves what the Lord has done for us. Look, it says there, so that it will be made known amongst the nations. We need to kind of use this as a way to point people to the Lord. And God has blessed us. God has been gracious this year. Yes, amen. It's been an off year, but God has still accomplished, you know, X, Y, and Z in our life. So it's not only for our own reflective time, but it's also to be kind of, as you will, a witness to those that we're around, our co-workers, our family members. Many of you have family members who are not believers. And you maybe that's a project or something that you intently think about every Thanksgiving, every time you get together with them. How can I influence them? How can I share the gospel? How can I impact them, influence them with my faith? And so you think through those things. This is what David was doing here. He's, verse 9 says, tell all his wonderful acts. So he's encouraging the people here to proclaim, you know, to be a witness, you know, for the Lord, you know, among the nations. You know, Israel, and if you study the Old Testament, Israel was God's chosen people, right? But God plainly tells them, it's not because you were more numerous or that you were any better than any of these other nations. He says, I chose you so that out of all these other nations that you would be a witness to them.
Amen.
And those, quote, seven nations, a lot of times that were around Israel, God had intended for them to be an example to all these other pagan nations around them to see, wow, well, how come they're blessed and God is doing, you know, what God do they serve? And so they would inquire. And that's the intent that God had planned when he chose Israel to be, you know, his chosen nation. And it's the same thing for you and I in the New Testament. We, you know, think about it. When we become Christians, we ask Jesus Christ into our lives. It's not, we just go immediately to heaven, do we? We're still here. We are to be God's witnesses. We're to share his wonderful acts and to proclaim it among the people around us.
Amen.
We're his witnesses. Jesus Christ is in heaven. He's sitting at the right hand of the Lord according to Revelation. And we are here. We are here. We're to be his witnesses. So do we talk about the Lord? You know, kind of make it personal and contemporary. Do we talk about the Lord among our coworkers, our family? Do we share openly? Or do we, have we felt, because I know what the world says. The world says, you can have your religion, you can have your faith, but just keep it private. Have we bought into that lie? That we can't have our faith, and it has to be private. You know, we can't dare bring it out in public. That's what the world wants to tell us. But I just want to challenge you, where are you at this morning as a church? Do you proclaim that? Does it come off your lips like it's normal? Or do we feel like every time I open my mouth, like, blah, 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 you know, the more you do that, the more you talk about the Lord and what he's done for you, the easier it will become just to continue to do that. So I don't know where you're at this morning. Maybe that's something that is hard or awkward for you, but I just want to encourage you, the more you talk of the Lord and his goodness, the easier it will become for you. So just, you know, do that. We have a lot of things to be thankful for. I had lunch this past week with a man who he's here, but he came to America several years ago, several decades ago, and he talked about how he came to Christ. And when he first read the Bible, it made sense. He didn't really have a church that he went to. This is all the way across the globe, all the way across the side of the planet. And he said he had to wait over a month to get his first Bible so he could read himself. And I just remember thinking, wow, sitting there meeting with him and another friend. It's like, man, I got Bibles all over the place. And this man was so thankful for the Bible he got that he had to wait a month for it. And so, you know, as Bob and some of these other men mentioned this morning, the things that we're thankful for, you know, we may overlook. There's a Bible, there's probably three Bibles in every can share and be a witness, we have to think about those things that we're thankful for. What am I thankful for? What do I have? What does the Lord bless me with? What can I share and be a witness for other people? That's number one on your outline. Number two, thankful people remember the past. This is probably the largest part of the psalm here that David wrote, verses 12 through 22. Let me just read these to you real quick. He says, "Remember the wonders he has done, his miracles, and the judgments he pronounced, O descendants of Israel, his servant, O sons of Jacob, his chosen ones. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He remembers his covenant forever. The word he commended for a thousand generations, the covenant he made with Abraham, the oath he swore to Isaac, he confirmed it to Jacob as a decree, to Israel as an everlasting covenant. To you I will give the land of Canaan and the portion that you inherit. When they were but just few in number, few indeed, strangers in it, they wandered from nation to nation, from kingdom to another. He allowed no man to oppress them. For their sake, he rebuked kings. Do not touch my anointed ones. Do my prophets no harm." And I'll stop right there. So you see this, a little bit of a history lesson. Now keep in mind, this is David looking back all the way to the covenant with Abraham. We've been going through the book of Genesis on Sunday nights, and we just kind of got through that section in chapter 21, 22 through 26 there between Abraham. And here you see David reminding the Israelites of their past. He says, you were few in number. You were but small. And you were wandering. You were going from place to place. He was trying to get them to remember just when it was Abraham. He made that promise to Abraham, and God kept that promise. And according to the scripture, it says, the word he committed for a thousand generations. God keeps his word. He remembers his word. And for us, we need to look at that too. So David, he kind of walks through, he goes through each of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He says, now, look where we are. He talks about the miracles and the things that they did, the different parts there. He says, remember this covenant that God made. He says, God protected them. And he was trying to help Israel look back and remember where they had come from. So for us today, do we look back? We may look at 2020 and we may say, well, I don't have much to be thankful for today or this year, but we're not even looking back in the past. And we should. We should say, wow, look at where I have been. You ever thought about that? Pastor Ben used to do that often. He would say, do you remember what it was like before you gave your life to Christ? Do you remember the life you had? Do you remember the differences that you had? For some of you, maybe you can identify with that. Some of you, it's a little bit hard to do that because you've had a relationship with the Lord for a long time. But each and every one of us, we need to look back. And we need to remember what God has done for us over the years.
Amen.
And how he has walked us through. I mentioned this earlier. Looking back is important. Go ahead and put up the slide there, Ashley. Israel had saw that God protected them and helped them. Does anybody know the difference? You may have noticed this in your Bible. There's a difference between 1 and 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles. Many of the stories kind of overlap, but do you know that the main difference between those two books? I'll tell you, it is this. 1 Kings was written during the time that it actually happened, in the time shortly thereafter that these kings and all these different things happened. But 1 and 2 Chronicles was written after they had come out of the Babylonian exile. It was written for them to look back, to remember what they had gone through. And as you read the Bible through, if you look at the differences between those two books, you'll find a lot of same stories, but you'll find some distinct differences. Chronicles is a very encouraging book. Most of the book is it kind of points to remember King David. A lot of Chronicles really focuses on King David, because as you know, after David and Solomon, the kings, after the kingdom split, by their, just given like the general statement there, the Chronicles really looks back in a positive light. The author of Chronicles was trying to encourage Israel. They had just come out of their 2020, so to speak. They had just come out of 70 years of exile as captives in Babylon. And the author said, hey, let me remind you about God's goodness. Let me show you what God did back in the day when you were a nation early on. So that's one of the key differences between Chronicles and 1 Kings. Chronicles is written in a positive light. It's meant to encourage Israel. And I think for us, that's a great example for us. You know, when we look back, go ahead and go to the next slide, Ashley. When we look back 5 or 10 years from now on 2020, that we're kind of talking about, what will we look at and say, wow, what did God do for us during this year, during this time? Will we be able to recognize those things? We're so human, because we are. We want to find the answers right now. We're so impatient, rather. We're a microwave society. We want to know all the answers. God, what are you doing? And how are you going to do this? And how are you going to handle this? And those questions that we have, sometimes they're not answerable. We will not know what God is doing in this season until we're able possibly to go forward a little bit in time. And then we can look back and we can say, you know what? God really did this to the church. And I think one of the things that we specifically, as a church here at Westside, I know the guys talk about it often, is the closeness that has come from having Pastor Ben retire and having to, everybody just pitch in, everybody, hey, this is it, we're working this, we're doing this together. And that was a big thing for us. But I think we can now say, looking back, it's like, that was one thing that God did for us as a church. And you can do the same thing in your life specifically. You can say, okay, wow, what happened to me in 2020? 5 years from now, and you can see how God maybe changed your heart about something, or maybe God caused you to be more financially frugal about something because you had to. You had no choice. We had to cut the cable. You had to do this. You had to learn how to make it and to squeeze, you know, all those different areas. But we're human, so we want to know those answers right now. But sometimes that's just not possible. So there's kind of the two sides of the coin there. We need to look back now and remember the things that we're thankful for that God has done for us in the past. But then I just want to say, hold up, just wait. For many of you, if you feel like, man, this year is just awful, it's horrible, just push the pause button and be able to go back 5 years from now and say, you know what? Looking back now, I can see what God did in my life, in my family's life in 2020. All right, let's go to the next one here. Number three, godly people give credit to the Lord. This is 23 through 33 in the chapter there. Let me read these to you quickly. Sing to the Lord, all the earth, proclaim his salvation day after day, declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among the people, for great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him, strength and joy are in his dwelling place. Ascribe to the Lord the families of the nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him all the earth. The world is firmly established, and it cannot be moved. Let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns. This section right here is all about giving credit to God. Several places he says there, in multiple places he says, all throughout this, you know, verse 23 there, he says, sing to the Lord, proclaim his salvation day after day. And then several places down in verse 29, 30 there, he says, ascribe to the Lord. Ascribe to the Lord this. I repeat, the word ascribe means to give credit, to point out, to attribute someone for the reason or the cause of it. And when David was encouraging the Israelites here to say, hey, all these things that you've been through in the past, it all kind of connects together. Don't forget to give credit to the Lord for those things. Now, we can look back at our lives and we can selfishly, we can say, I did that, I worked hard, I did this. But we need to remember that who gave us the strength, who gave us the ability to do those things. We need to point and give credit where credit is due. It's the difference, you know. We can all be thankful and grateful for the things that God does in our life, but we need to control that pride when we do that. We don't need to make it a brag. We need to keep it humble and say, all right, Lord, you've done this in my life, and make sure that we're pointing to him and not ourselves. We do that. Verse 25, 26, it says, he is to be feared above all other gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols. They're nothing. You know? But when we come down to it, all these other gods that are around that the Israelites were quote unquote worshiping were just a bunch of rocks and pieces of wood and stuff. And David's trying to say, hey, God is the one true God.
Amen.
We can do the same thing in our lives. We can say, you know what, there's a lot of stuff we can point to. Oh, education. I got that education. I got that 4-year degree at that school. Yeah, that's what helped me do that. And we can point to a lot of the things, but we need to make sure that we point to the source that God is doing that. I'm skipping a little bit because I still love to do that, but I just really want to I want to encourage you. I was going to play a song for you this morning, but I'm going to just encourage you to go look it up yourself. There's a new song out called Evidence by Josh Baldwin. And it's a great song. And I just want to encourage you, if you'll maybe write that in your notes. If you haven't heard that song before, you can Google it later. But go find Evidence by Josh Baldwin. And give that a listen to this morning. That song really, to me, points out that, you know, we see the evidence of God working in our lives. The song says all over our lives. And I think that's important for us to recognize. When we live and we move and we have that relationship with God, that we recognize it first, and then secondly, that we proclaim that to other people. That we give God the credit for everything. Let me go to the last point, number 4. Thankful people seek God, seek the Lord for their salvation. This is in the last 3 verses here. Verse 34 through 36. Let me read these to you real briefly here. It says, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Cry out, save us, O God our Savior. Gather us and deliver us from the nations, that we may give thanks to your holy name, that we may glory in your praise. Praise be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Then all the people said, amen, praise the Lord. So they kind of finished. David shared this psalm with everybody. The people rejoiced. This last point is going to be brief, but it's short. You know, this last section here, these last 3 verses came from Psalm 106, and all the psalms we kind of mashed together. But David says that we need to remember to call upon the Lord. We need to seek him for our salvation. I don't know where you're at this morning. I don't know if you have done that. You've come to a place in your life where you have call upon the Lord, and he is your salvation. For many of you, you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. But maybe there's someone in here today that does not have that relationship with Christ. Go ahead. Romans 10:13. We'll put that on the board. This is from the New Testament. It says, for everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's kind of what I kind of equate to the Old Testament passage there in verse 33, 34. The Bible teaches us that if we will call upon the Lord, we will have a relationship with him. We will be saved. That's what Paul teaches in Romans. If you're here this morning and you said, I've been checking this church out, I've been checking Christianity out, I know a bunch of facts about who Jesus is, but I don't have a relationship, I've never called upon him as my Savior, I want to invite you to be able to do that this morning by saying a prayer. And it's not the words of the prayer that mean something, but it's your heart condition. If you would like to get a relationship with Jesus Christ in your life, you can do that by asking him to come into your life. And I would just ask you, if everybody would close your eyes, bow your heads, nobody walking around or getting up, Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. Today, Lord, I want to ask you to come into my life. Help me to follow you as I place my faith in you and make you Lord. Help me to forsake all other idols and to live for you alone. In Jesus' name I pray. If you pray that prayer this morning, I'd love to just know about it, just kind of help you, encourage you in your next step of where you need to be as you follow the Lord. This morning, the altar is going to be open if you'd like to come down and pray. Maybe there's something here this morning that you feel like, I need to share more about the gospel. I need to go back. I need to remember more what the Lord has done for me in my past and not look so much in the present. Maybe for you this morning, you feel like I need to start getting credit for where credit is due. Say, Lord, you're the one who's done this. You're the one who's done this in my life, and I need to point people to you. If you want to come down and pray, the altar's open for you this morning. Let's pray, and then I'll turn it over to Rebecca. Dear God, Lord, this is your time. Lord, I pray that for the church this morning, if you are moving in someone's heart, in their mind, in their spirit this morning, I pray that they would just be obedient to you.
Amen.
God, I pray that you'll help us this Thanksgiving not to look at what we don't have, but help us to remember what we do have in that relationship with you. Help us to remember to look back, to open our mouths, and to share openly, boldly, the great good things that you have done in each of our lives as your believers. Lord, I pray that as we come to this time of invitation, this is your time, Lord. May your Holy Spirit move here. May you push and prod people where it's needed. God, we love you and just thank you for all this time. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Services tonight and Wednesday, resume next Sunday, although next week the regular church. At this time, we're going to ask after the offering plates are passed, those that are serving the food, I'm going to ask if you kind of sneak out and just get prepared. Woody's going to come just a minute and bring a prayer for the food. So once you go out, you can go ahead and just eat. If you're a guest with us today and you said, I didn't sign up, that's okay. We have tons of extra food, and we want to bless you. If you'd like to stay, we have Cracker Barrel that's been catered in, and we have in our fellowship hall there. We'd love to have you stay with us. If you feel like you don't want to stay or you can't stay, you're welcome to. We have to-go containers. You're welcome to take that to-go container and take it with you. So do whatever you feel comfortable with. It's a different time. So, but at this time, before I ask you to go ahead and pray it, and if you, those who are serving the food, if you'll come out. Mm-hmm.